Good morning, everyone. Good to see you all on this beautiful, sunny Sunday morning. I'm glad to be here this morning. I'm glad you're here this morning. I want to talk about our eternal expectation, the eternal expectation, our hope. We're going to be reading from the book of Romans. If you have your Bibles, please. Turn to the book of Romans chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verses 18 through 25. Romans chapter 8. If you're using an electronic device, I would just ask you to mute it. Put it on vibrate. Put your phasers on stun. Romans chapter 8. Verses 18 through 25. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Rome, he says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it." Lord, I ask your help this morning, God. I pray for the anointing upon the preaching of your word. Lord, I pray that my words won't fall to the ground, but they will find their place in the hearts of your people. God, I ask, Lord, that you will speak to each of us through your word and be glorified in all of these things. We pray in Jesus' name. Eternal expectation, our hope. Or eternal perspective, if you will. The early church suffered many trials. Christianity was certainly not for the faint of heart in the first century. We know of Nero's obsession with torturing Christians. I won't share with you this morning how heinous some of his acts were, but he tortured and murdered Christians by the thousands. We know of the sadistic practices of the Roman arena, how Christians were thrown in to fight trained, experienced gladiators. They were thrown into dens of lions and torn apart by wild beasts. We know of those things in the early church. The Apostle Peter, when he wrote to strangers scattered throughout the Roman province of Asia Minor, pilgrims, if you will, strangers, those who were not temporal, who were not permanent residents, just like us. We're not permanent residents here of planet Earth. We're just passing through. This world is not our home. We're pilgrims. We're sojourners and strangers. And Peter wrote to such people. Peter wrote his first letter of joyful hope to give believers an eternal perspective on their earthly lives. They were beginning to experience the fiery trials of persecution. Persecution was just beginning to heat up. And Peter's readers, those who were hearing this, were beginning to experience the persecution. And Peter reminds them that they had been begotten again unto a lively hope. Literally a living hope. A hope that is alive. A real hope. He wrote to give eternal perspective on their earthly lives. And I believe, friends, that oftentimes we lose eternal perspective on our earthly lives. We tend to look at things as they are around us. And I believe that we seem to be found holding tightly to this world, into the stuff of this world, even though it's fleeting, even though it's passing by. But we wake up in the morning and we face the world and we see it as it is and we embrace it as it is. And oftentimes that's all we see. And when we face difficult times, we're often tempted to lose hope. Hope is a wonderful gift that God has given us and a powerful tool. Hope in our hearts keeps us going. Hope allows us to endure the trials that we have to face. But when hope is lost, all things seem lost. The Apostle Paul also, in our text, he was also writing of hope. In fact, he uses the word hope in this letter to the Romans 14 times. He stresses the hope that we have in Christ. And I want this morning, briefly, I want us to gain eternal perspective as we look at this hope that we have. Amen. Are you ready? First of all, calculation. If you're taking notes, calculation. It's a comparison here. Paul says in verse 18, "For I reckon that the sufferings in this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." I reckon. If you're from down south, you hear that word all the time. I reckon. But to know what it means, it means to calculate, as in a mathematical equation. I reckon. You take the information at hand. You gather the data. You analyze the data. You look at all the facts that are at your disposal, and you analyze the data. It is a deducing of the facts until you reach a reasonable conclusion. Did I lose anyone? This word reckon, it means to calculate. It means to analyze, to take all that you know and to calculate it, analyze it, and then reach a reasonable conclusion. In other words, considering all things. That's what Paul is saying when he says, I reckon. He's saying, I have considered all things. I've considered everything. See, friends, we have to consider all things this morning. Everything we have to take into consideration in our calculation and in our analysis. This world is not it. This world is not it. This life is not all there is. How many are happy to hear that? This is not all there is. In fact, this life, although it comes first in order, it is secondary to the life that comes next. You got it? It comes first in order, but it is secondary to what God has in store for his people. Paul said, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. 1 Corinthians 15:19. Listen, if we woke up this morning, if you woke up this morning and you looked at this day, although it's a sunny day, it's beautiful weather this morning, but if you looked at this day and you looked at the difficulties that you have in your life and you thought about the ones that might come tomorrow and you analyzed the world in its current state of affairs and you had no hope in Christ in a life that comes, you would be, as I, most miserable. Would you not? Would we not? In light of the promises of eternity in heaven, a reasoned conclusion is that this ain't it. This ain't all there is. Remember, Abraham was promised a land. God spoke to him, called him. I know I use Abraham a lot, but he's a perfect example. He was called out of Ur of the Chaldees. God sent him to, and he promised him a land of promise. We call it the promised land. A land of promise in the future. Moses tells us that it was a land that would flow with milk and honey. The staples, milk and honey are wonderful to have for all of your sweet tooth and all of your cooking needs. And milk and honey represents everything you could ever need. This land of promise. But look at the hardships that they had endured. Look at what happened from Abraham, who is the founder of the Hebrew nation, the beginning of Israel. Look at all the hardships that he and his seed endured from the time he was called out of the Chaldees until the time the Israelites went into the promised land. There were battles to face. There were enemies to attack. There was sickness. There was a wilderness. There was a little thing called Egypt. And they endured all of these things until they got finally to the land of promise. Now, I have to say, much of their difficulties were of their own fault, like most of ours are of our own fault, but they were hardships nonetheless. Now, I know I quote this verse often, but Jesus said, in this world, ye shall have tribulation. In this world, in this life, in this age, we're going to have tribulation. Now, that word tribulation, it's not speaking of the great tribulation, but it means sufferings, and it means afflictions, trials, difficulties. Now, they could be physical. Some are facing physical trials and difficulties. They could be mental distress. They could be torment of all kinds. As I spoke last week, the issues are as varied as the people here today. We all have difficulties from time to time. But whatever it is you're going through, and whatever it is you have gone through, and whatever it is you think you might be facing, none of those things can possibly compare to the glory which is about to be revealed in us. Amen. To know that one day this will all be behind you. One day soon, the Lord is going to send forth the angel. We're going to hear the shout of the archangel. We're going to hear the trump of God. And we're gone into a place that our Lord has prepared for us. Church, it's coming. It's coming. But unless you have a real faith, hear me when I say this, a real faith in the eternal promises of God, you will not be able to reach the proper conclusion. This calculation, this analysis of the data. If you don't have a real solid faith in the promise of God, I should say this, if you don't have a real solid faith in the promiser, then you will not, when you do your analysis, when you do your calculation, when you look at the facts presented to you, you will not arrive at the proper conclusion. But if you know that every promise that God has made, he has committed to fulfilling, if you have that real faith in him, and in his promises, then when you analyze everything around you, you will reach that proper conclusion. You will then have that hope that God has given us. Paul says, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestations of the Son of God. Now, this earnest expectation in the Greek language is one word. And it literally means watching with outstretched neck. Literally. You really want to see something, you're looking through the crowd, you're looking over the tops of people's heads, you're straining to see. That's this word. Creation is in this earnest expectation. It literally means strained expectancy. Or an eager longing. You getting this? An eager longing. It's applied figuratively to creation. Paul says, he uses the word the creature. Literally it means creation. All created things. Everything that God has created is represented in this. And listen, he applies it figuratively to creation. But he says that the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. The earth and all of creation. So what he does is he personifies all creation. It's as if the earth itself is looking for the coming of the Redeemer. It's as if everything on the planet, everything in the sky, in the space, is personally looking for the redemption of mankind. You get that? That's pretty interesting. But you know the earth doesn't really look, and the trees don't really want and long But Paul puts, he personifies all of creation as if it is longing for the redemption of mankind. All of creation stands waiting, watching, and longing. And then the curse. The curse on nature. Why is all creation eagerly waiting for the redemption of mankind? Listen, creation was subjected to the curse by the sin of Adam. If you remember Genesis chapter 3, when Adam and Eve fell, and God spoke to Adam and called him out, sent them out of the garden, shut off the garden, that place of Eden, it's paradise. It was Shangri-La. It was everything. But they lost it when they sinned. And when they sinned, God cursed the snake for its part in the fall of mankind, and cursed women with pain and childbearing, cursed the land. Listen. Weeds. God put weeds upon the earth and thorns and thistles. The ground was cursed. Natural disasters, violent weather. All of nature was cursed when Adam sinned. Nature itself is innocent. Paul says here that a creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. I mean, the tree in my backyard didn't climb through the window and punch me in the nose. My tree didn't do anything wrong. You know, the ground didn't do anything wrong. All of nature itself is innocent. It did nothing against God. And yet, creation is cursed because of the sins of man. That word, subjected to vanity, empty, without any real purpose. Listen, think of this fallen world. The world itself and all of creation without God. Just imagine for a moment all of this without God. What good does this world do? What good does it do? I mean, really, what purpose does it serve? What is the end result? What is the outcome year after year after year of planet Earth? What is it producing of any goodness? Listen, I don't mean to be negative, but let's look at this for a moment. So we get up and we wake up in the morning and we go through life and we live and we die. And in between, there's a little happiness and a lot of heartache. Is that life for a lot of people? And so we get up and we go through it every day, and every day we continue. And what is the end result? Ashes to ashes and dust to dust. Listen, Jesus said, "For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" What does this world matter? If you were Bill Gates or Bezos or Elon Musk or whoever else is a Bill, what would it matter if you had all of this world and you lost your soul? There's nothing here. And all of creation is waiting for the regeneration of all things. Listen, man brought the curse upon creation when he sinned. Right? Genesis 3. And all the suffering and sorrow and pain and sickness and earthquakes and tornadoes and hurricanes and all of that is a result. But when man is regenerated, the curse will be lifted. See, the world, all nature is innocent. It did nothing. It's suffering from the sin of man. But when mankind is fully redeemed, then the curse will be lifted and all of creation will rejoice and celebrate. So all of creation is waiting for us to be fully redeemed. Until then, there are thorns in our path of life. There are weeds in your garden. There's poison ivy in your backyard. There's stink bugs and black widows and hornets and snakes and winter. Until then, cats scratch, dogs bite, and lions will continue stalking their prey. And pollution is just the evidence of the sinfulness of mankind. Now, I'm not an environmentalist. I'm not a tree hugger. I'm not, you know, that's not my religion. I don't think we should pollute. I am conservationist, if you will. When I go fishing, whatever I bring in, I take back out. When I go camping, whatever I bring, I take back out. If I find things laying around the ground that somebody put there, I pick it up and take it out. I don't want to see the world polluted. I don't want to see the water polluted. I don't want to see the air polluted. But that's just a result of the sinfulness of mankind. Everything we touch, we pollute. Everywhere we go, we leave garbage. I said before, we've polluted the moon, now we've polluted Mars. We're looking for something else to pollute. Leave our junk. Everything we touch, we pollute. The word corruption suggests deterioration. When Paul says, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption, that word indicates not only corruption, but deterioration. In other words, things will always get progressively worse. As much as we attempt to clean the air, it's going to get progressively worse. The earth is, listen, John said it in 1 John, that it is on its way out. The world, it's not forever. This present world is not forever. The whole creation groans, metaphorically. It groans under the weight of corruption. Paul says that it's in travail. It travails. Now, I never gave birth, but I understand that as a woman in labor, the pains get greater and closer together just before the birth. So you feel that first tinge, that first pain. Uh-oh, it's coming, right? Call the doctor. Don't go yet. How far are they apart? No, don't go yet. And then progressively, as you're getting closer to birth, the pains get more intense and they get closer together, and it's building up until the crescendo when the baby is born. Can't you feel the birth pangs becoming greater and closer together? Can't you feel it? Don't you sense the travail of all of creation in earnest expectation of the redemption of mankind? The deserts of the world are all barren. I stood in the Judean desert. I thank God for the opportunity. I stood in the Judean desert, one of the lowest points on earth, the Dead Sea being in the Judean desert being the very lowest point on planet earth. It's one of the hottest points on earth. In the summer, over 120 degrees. There is less than 2 inches of rainfall per year. It is one of the driest, hottest, deepest places on planet Earth. We floated in the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea, 37% salt. It is desolate. It is lifeless. Nothing could live in the Dead Sea. Occasionally there is a bacteria that is found, but other than that, no life. It can't survive in that salty condition. It's groaning. The deserts of the world are groaning. The Dead Sea is groaning, waiting for the redemption of mankind. Isaiah said, "The desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose." God said through Isaiah, "I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." Ezekiel wrote of rivers that will flow into the Dead Sea and revive it. It will be teeming with fish. That which is desolate, that which is lifeless, year after year, century after century, will one day be revived and teeming with fish, and all wildlife will come there for refuge. And the deserts will blossom as the rose. Listen, the deserts, those barren wilderness, the deserts of the world hold billions of seeds that are carried there on the wind. The seeds in your garden, when they let go of the seeds, often they're blown in the wind and they're carried up into the atmosphere and they're dispensed throughout the whole world. And seeds are lying in the deserts, those barren deserts of the world. And one day they will be watered and the deserts will blossom. This is God's promise. So as we look at all these things, as we consider everything, let's make sure we calculate properly and we arrive at the proper conclusion. See, thirdly, we have confidence. If you're taking notes, confidence. Listen, Paul talks about all creation. He personifies, metaphorically speaking, of all creation groaning and straining their neck with eager anticipation, expectation. But then he says this, but he says, and not only they. Not only is all of creation longing for redemption, but that's referring to all creation, not only they, but he says, but ourselves also. We too are groaning. We too are in the midst of birth pangs and in the trials of life, just waiting and longing for the return of our Lord. We too are straining our necks to see his coming. I don't know about you, but I'm looking with eager expectation for the clouds to open. I'm listening every day for the first note of that tune, or the trump of God sounds. I'm longing and waiting with eager expectation for those skies to open up and the Lord to call us home. I can feel the travail. Paul says that we, listen, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. The first fruits of the Spirit, friends, when we think of first fruits, agriculturally, it's the first ripe fruit of the season. If you planted a harvest of wheat, the first fruits generally come where the seed is first planted, obviously, chronologically. It will begin to germinate and grow. And you think of in the days of old, they didn't seed with machines, it was by hand. So the first fruits, the earliest planted, when it first reaches ripeness, like the wheat of a field. Now, you might have acres of wheat, but you only have a small patch of the first fruits. It's not the whole thing, but it's part of the whole thing. And it's not just a promise, it's real. And so you gather the first fruits. By the way, they belong to God, but that's another sermon for another time. But those first fruits, agriculturally, or you plant trees and you go out to your what do you call those places where trees grow? Thank you so much. Wait till you get to 61. So you go out to your orchard and you see those trees and there's that, you know, most of the apples are green and a little red, but there's one, the first tree that produces the first apple, and you take it off the tree and you bite into it and it squishes all over your face and you're tasting. Do you have the harvest? No, that's a long way down the road, but you have a taste. You have a part of the whole, and it's not just a promise. Man, it's real. And the juice running down your chin is proof. It's real. And you rejoice in the harvest because you've tasted of the fruit. The first fruits of the Spirit. It's a first installment, if you will. We have the earnest. You know what earnest? If you go to buy a house, you know, it's a, say, these days, it's $1 million because everything is crazy. But say you go to buy a house for, you know, a couple $100,000, $200,000. I don't know anybody here. Maybe you do, but I don't know anybody who's got $200 in their pocket. So you don't necessarily pay cash. You go and you take out a loan, but before you do, you put a down payment. You say, I want this house, and you put a down payment, right? You give them, what is it? It's a pledge. It's saying, I haven't bought the whole house yet, but I'm giving you real money. It's a part of the whole. It's a pledge. It's an earnest that I'm buying the house. It's an earnest of all the money that's going to come. We've received the earnest of our inheritance. We have a down payment. We have a pledge. God has given us a taste of the Holy Spirit, if you will, a part, not the whole, But more than a promise, he's real. And we have him. He's ours. He's in us. It's a pledge. It's a promise. More than a promise, it's a reality. But a pledge of the whole, if you will. It's a pledge that we who have the Spirit shall in the end be saved. It's a guarantee. I love that song. And by the way, we'll sing it at the end of the service. But listen, I asked you to listen to the words that we sang. Let's just listen to the words of this song. Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. I'm purchased by God. Right? Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Blessed assurance. A foretaste of glory divine. Let's see a modern chorus compete with that. Our hope. This is our hope. Listen. Our hope is in the promise of God to save. Now, listen. It's not semantics. This is important we understand. Hope is a favorable and confident expectation. It's not a wish. It's a guarantee. Hope, listen, I think the New King James states it better, more accurately here. On occasion, that might be the case, but it says, because this is closer to the Greek, for we were saved in this hope. We were saved, not by hope, but in this hope. Listen, we aren't saved by hope, but by grace through faith. And that, not of ourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We're saved by grace through faith. But listen, faith is an unseen present. It's based on the past. Faith, in essence, looks backward. I know I've said this many times before, but faith looks backward. It's present because of what happened back here. The Father sent the Son came, he lived, he died. I don't mean to minimize that. It's incredible. And because of that, he rose again and he ascended on high. He's interceding for us. And because of that, we have faith in what happened. So now we have faith today. But the unseen present. Hope is an unseen future. We have faith and hope. By faith we received our salvation. In hope we have an eager expectation or confidence. Does that make sense? Listen, we have salvation thus far only by faith and in hope. This hope keeps us, preserves us, sustains us in all of our trials. And that's important because trials are often so great that nothing but the prospect of future deliverance upholds us. Sometimes trials are so great. You look back at what Christ has done and you say, that's wonderful. I rejoice in what he has done. But where am I now? And the trials that I'm facing are overwhelming before me. That's where hope comes in. We have faith, but now we have hope. And I could face anything if I have that hope. Anything if we have calculated correctly and we've reckoned properly, then we have that assurance. I'll close with this. Hopefully it'll make more sense as I close. Hope is something that you can't see or touch. But kind of by definition, when we speak of that, when Paul's speaking of that hope, he's speaking of the object hoped for. All right? Not just hope itself, but the object hoped for. Let me say it again. For we are saved through hope, in hope, but hope that is seen, or the thing hoped for, that is seen is no longer hoped for, right? If what you're hoping for, you get, you don't hope anymore. You got it in your hand. It's right there. So what we already have, we don't hope for. But where there is a strong desire for something and the expectation of receiving it, we can wait for it with patience or perseverance, like a Christmas present. Dear Santa. No, but you asked for something. What do you want for Christmas this year? What do you want for Christmas this year? I have no earthly idea. People ask, I don't have any idea. But if you did, you know, you want that, whatever it is, you want that brand new Xbox, you want that Mercedes Benz, F-250 diesel, but you want something, right? And you've asked for it, you know you're going to get it. You know it's not under the tree. You haven't found any receipts that it's been purchased. It's not on the bank statement. But you know you're going to get it because the person who is buying it for you loves you and cares for you, and you know with all assurance that you're going to get it. But it's not yours yet. You don't have it anymore. But you're not wishing to get it. You're not hoping like, oh man, I hope they bought it. No, your hope is guaranteed. You're just waiting for Christmas morning when you walk out and find it under the tree or in your driveway or wherever, and then you enjoy the fullness of it. You don't have it yet, but it's yours. You go and you tell everyone, I'm getting new furniture for Christmas. I'm getting it. Right? Not I'm hoping to get it. I'm getting it. There's an excitement. There's an expectation. It's yours, but not yet. Well, we have an earnest of our inheritance, a down payment, if you will, a promise, a pledge, a taste, a real taste, a real part of the entire promise. The deposit securing the full possession of a later time. Friends, compared to our future glory, could you imagine the place that the Creator, Jesus Christ, has made for us? Time is of no essence to God, but imagine 2,000 years He has been preparing a place in the Father's house for us. It's an eternal place. You don't have to cut the grass. You don't have to shovel the snow. If there is snow, it's warm. Or if you like cold, I suppose it's cold. But it's Eden restored. It's heaven on earth. It's everything you could ever want. And it's yours for eternity. Compared to our future glory, our present trials are nothing. Oh, I don't mean to minimize them, but compared, I reckon, I have analyzed all of this nonsense. I gotta live it. I have to endure it. But when it's over, hallelujah. Hallelujah. We'll be removed from all corruption. We'll be given glorified bodies. I wake up in the morning now, it sounds like applause. Everything cracking and popping. It's like, But we'll have glorified bodies. No more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more death. Ultimately, a new heaven and a new earth. Everything tainted by sin will be removed. And He'll make all things new. Can you feel the travail? The birth pangs, as it were. Hold on, child of God. Hold on. He's preparing a place, a home for us in heaven. Hey, maybe it's already done. Maybe it's already done. Maybe today He puts the final nail in the wallboard on the house. I don't know. Maybe it's already prepared and ready. He could come this day. He could come this very moment and catch us up to be with Him. Look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's praise Him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the promise that you've given us. Thank you, Lord, that we have reckoned that this present sorrow and suffering is nothing to be compared with the glory that's about to be revealed in us. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we are straining our necks. We are looking with eager expectation for the coming of our Messiah, the coming of our Christ, our Redeemer, our Lord. Lord, when you complete the redemption, you complete the regeneration in us, giving us glorified bodies in your holy presence. Father, if there's anyone here that's been discouraged or afraid, Lord, in any way depressed, help them, Lord, to reckon properly, to realize, Lord, that the promises in Christ are all yea and amen. Encourage your people, Lord. Help us to hold on to this hope that we have that keeps us, Lord God. And I just pray, Lord, that you will guide every step we take and be glorified in each life. Father, we do pray. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us praise our Savior all the day long. Amen. Let's praise Him all day, today, and every day, for He is worthy. Glory to God. Be blessed.
us, Lord, to worship you as you deserve.